to make an advance directive, which is a legal document by which he can wish how he needs, how he wants to be cared and how he doesn't want to be cared. It also gives the patient the capacity to appoint a nominated representative who could either be his caregiver or any known member or any other member whom he chooses. This representative have the functions to support the patient in his decisions, able to consent on behalf of him, and he is a person who is able, who is the person who should able to protect the right of the patient when he is under the treatment. These advance directives needs to be online registered with the concerned board. But at the time of emergency, these advance directives should not be cared upon. Next, which is the most salient feature of this act, are the certain rights which has been given to the patients with mental illness. Likely the rights to access mental health care and treatment. These services should be affordable, should be of good quality, available in sufficient quantity, should be accessible geographically and without any discrimination. And it should be provided in such a manner that it is acceptable to both the family members as well as the patients. Next, there is a right to the right to community living, in which it shows that the patient of mental illness should not be segregated from the society. And he should not remain in a mental health establishment just because he's a homeless or nobody is there. So the government has to provide some measures by which they can get this person into a community. Then there is the right to live with dignity and protection from cruel, inhuman and degrading treatment, in which the patient has been given the right that he should be able to get proper clothes, there should be a clean environment in which he has been treated, and he should not be, he should be protected from any abuse, whether it's a sexual abuse or a verbal abuse. There is a right to equality and non-discrimination. And there is a one main highlight of this point is that the government has allowed, asked the insurer to make provision for the medical insurance in mental health. And it should be of the same quality as of the other physical illnesses. Then there is a right to information, in which the patient of mental illness should be provided with adequate information regarding the criteria of the admission, the nature of the illness he has been having, the proposed treatment plan, and all the basic medical records should be provided to the informant, and if it's not there, then the nominated representative should be know about all of this. Then there is a right to confidentiality, which is in respect to his mental health, his treatment, his mental health care, and his physical health care. And there is a feature which government has made emphasis on, that no information should be released to any media without the consent of the patient. Then the rights to personal contacts and communication, which provide the patient to have the right to make calls, to have the persons to make emails while he has been admitted in the mental health establishment. Then the patient has the right to avail free legal services to exercise any of his rights which have been noted in this act. And if he is not satisfied with any of the treatment which has been given, he has the right to complain about deficiency of these services to the concerned board. Next, the act talk about the provision for independent admission. That is, if the patient has the capacity to make decisions, it needs not to be consented or presence of any other member for the admission of such patient. But in case of supported admission, it can be done up to 30 to 90 days as decided by the concerned board. There is also a provision which will preserve the rights of the patient, that if any minor or female patient has been admitted to any of the mental health establishment, it should be reported to the concerned board within 3 days. And in case of male adults, it should be reported within 7 days. The act also has a provision for emergency treatment, which can be done up to 72 hours in any of the public health establishment. And the medical officer in charge of that public health estimation has to make sure that the patient should be reviewed with any of the mental health professional during that stay. The act prohibits certain treatments which have been given to the mental illness, patients with mental illness, like direct electroconvulsive therapy, which is not without anesthesia. Then the act also prohibits use of sterilization in either male or female. And chaining of the patients with mental illness has been prohibited by this act. Last but not the least is the decriminalization of suicide, which have been talked about by Dr. Hershit, So these were some of the salient features which have been given in this act and which is a very welcome move by the government regarding this act. So thank you. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Pankaj. He has raised two very important points again about advanced directive and nominated representative. The idea looks very nice, but to have a point rebuttal, I invite Dr. Rahul Ganesh to give his views about the act. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. Dr. Harshit and Dr. Pankaj have advocated well for the Mental Health Act, but there are many pitfalls with regards to the treatment of the persons with mental illness. The act mainly focuses on the care of the persons with mental illness who are admitted in the hospital setting and have ignored the treatment of them who have been in the community. It appears that the act was made with the hypothesis that mental health professionals and the family members are the enemies of the persons with mental illness. They are trying to violate their rights. The family members are the one who cares for the patient and bears the unpleasant behavior, and they are the one who are willing to get support the person with mental illness during the treatment. And the act is not fostered to support the family members in providing care. And there are specific issues like capacity to make treatment decision, advanced directive, and nominated representative. For example, the capacity to make mental health care decisions might be have dangerous consequences, like the patient may refuse the treatment due to his absent insight, or his symptoms may come in the way of decision making. And the family members usually find it difficult to get them admitted in the individuals of severe mental illness, especially those who have no insight into their illness. And the act by default considers that the person with mental illness has the capacity, and one has to prove that before initiating involuntary treatment that he is not having the capacity. One has to approach the mental health board to take permission to initiate involuntary treatment. This would add an enormous burden to the family members and mental health providers in treating the involuntary patients with severe mental illness. With advanced directive, the person with mental illness decides which type of treatment he prefers. The person with mental illness may revoke, amend, or cancel advanced directives many times in a day, and if he has to write about the way in which he has to be treated if he develops a mental illness, he would be writing, if I develop a bipolar illness, then what are the methods in which he would be treated? If I am developing schizophrenia, then what are the cases in which he is getting treated? For example, if he is writing like, if I have developed schizophrenia, I have to be treated with this kind of medications. If these medications are costly, or if he is writing that he has to be getting treatment from a corporate hospital or private hospital, then who is the one who is going to take care of this cost bearings that the patient, the treatment demands? And if he is have to write everything, then it would be like a textbook. The already burdened society, like doctors, has to read multiple texts to treat the patient, and we have to read all these textbooks for in treating individual cases also. This makes the treatment very cumbersome, and it will add burden to the family members too. With regards to the nominated representative, if a person with mental illness may revoke his decision of nomination of a representative and may alter this many times in a day too. The Indian population is not ready for such a departure in which the family members are the whole caregivers of the patient, in which this Mental Health Act is being shifted from a whole family setting to a single nominated representative person. This restriction may lead the family members to disown the patient itself. And in a form, it may result in abandoning of the patient, it may result in wandering of the patient, which will abolish the whole purpose of Mental Health Act itself. And Dr. Pankaj have talked about confidentiality, but here the nominated representative will have unlimited access to the records of the patient with mental illness, which itself is considered to be a breach of confidentiality. And with regards to treatment of the patient with mental illness, ECT is usually given in acutely ill patients waiting for the board's approval for ECT in minors or an emergency setting in an acutely ill is a cumbersome procedure and will deny the patients of the necessary treatment that is he requires at that time. And treating psychiatrists need to have the rights to decide about the emergency treatment with consent of the family members. Hence, the act has many drawbacks which confuses the treatment decision, it increases the burden of the family members, and it would delay the necessary treatment in acutely ill and would make the treatment of mental illness more cumbersome.
Thank you, Rahul. To extend this point further, we psychiatrists are most concerned about the fact that the general hospital psychiatric units have been also included in the Mental Health Care Act, which might push psychiatry back into the bygone areas where the private practitioners will find it difficult to open a new facility. These are few points which are for and against the debate. And this brings me to the one of the editorials which was published in the National Medical Journal of India, and the question still remains open. The editorial said the mental health care bill at that point of time, exotic in nature, quixotic in scope, but let's take the plunge, shall we, is the question which needs to be answered. I would request Dr. Rohit to share his views about it. After that, we will open the session for some questions from the audience. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Saurabh. Indian society has walked a long way from 1912 to 2017. In 1912, we launched the Indian Lunacy Act under the British Empire. And now we are in the era wherein we have the recently launched in April, the Mental Health Care Act, which will be soon formulated into action plan in the next upcoming year. There have been a lot of changes and things have moved about a lot. And definitely, as every coin has two faces, everything has a positive and a negative side attached to it. The recently launched Act is also not apart from it. As we have already heard, there are pros and cons to this essay to a great extent. But all in all, it seems to be a very welcome step. It considers the UNCRPDs, that is the United Nations Conventions for Rights to Persons with Disabilities, their adjunctures, which has been followed all over the world, and everywhere people are trying to change their own, amending their own laws to a certain extent so that the disabilities are the persons who are having disabilities and they are given rights, they are accumulated into their constitutional laws to a certain extent. And from that perspective, the current act by India seems to be a positive step towards that direction. So I congratulate all the four of them to bring important issues to the forefront. I have one question to ask, actually, on my behalf. In the light of the currently launched MATE issue by this Mental Health Foundation, what does the current Mental Health Care Act talks about the child and adolescent issues, their perspective, their guidance regarding in the current law?
The treatment for the child is the guardian who is responsible for the treatment for a child. And in the absence of a guardian, it is the mental health board who would appoint a guardian to oversee the treatment for the child. The parents can nominate someone in their absence to act as a nominated representative. One shortcoming of the Mental Health Act is that ECT is not allowed in a person who is under 18 years of age. This seems to go with the general perception that ECT is a cruel form of punishment. Well, we know that scientific evidence does not say so. So that is one of the provisions of the Mental Health Act, which I would like to raise.
Sir, regarding what Dr. Tamanun had said, first I come to the ECT part. The Act has shown that the ECT in minor is prohibited, but if a psychiatrist thinks that it needs to be there, then he can request the concerned board for the requisition of ECT in, with the prescribed what needs to be done, how ECT should be done in this patient, and why it is needed. Second, regarding a minor, that Tamil Nadu said that the nominated representative act has been there in this. Also, the government has the duty to promote child health mental services. It has been given the duty to the government to promote it. Next point which has been given is that there should be a regular authority which will check all the minor admissions in the hospital. It needs to be noted to the concern board within, as I said, within 3 days to the concern board. And if any admission prolong more than 30 days, it should be given information to the higher authority regarding those kind of admissions. These are some of the points which the Act talk about the minor patients.
So, thank you all. We would like some questions from the audience if they have, and our panelists will be more than happy to answer them.
I'm Sunidhi, I'm from AIIMS. Well, sir, I'll be asking a question, two questions basically I have, and both of them are for the speakers who are speaking for the motion. The first question which goes is, since you have talked about both policy perspective and patient perspective, the first question which I'll ask is regarding the policy perspective, which is that the bill has not mentioned any budgeting between the center and the state allocation. Like how much budget they're going to provide. So how do we know how the allocation of the budgeting will be done? Because we know that different states have like different, the needs are very different for different states. So how does the budget allocation come into play, which neither of us know, and there has been no mention in the Mental Health Care Act. The second question for the patient perspective is that, suppose let's take a case scenario. There is a woman, she is now given the power for anticipation for her own caregiver, she chooses her daughter because, for some reason, she has not, she's not maintaining good relations with other family members, and she finds herself in depression. 2 years later, she's hospitalized. Her daughter comes rushing to her aid, and then after some time, due to the long treatment, her own marital discord is there, suppose. Now the woman, she goes to the Mental Health Care Act, and there is a clause in that which states that we can also have remuneration for the services which we are providing. Suppose she starts asking for property rights now, and the mother cannot deprive her of that now. So she is granted the property rights. After taking the property, now she decides that she wants to abandon her mother. How does the bill act and guarantee that the woman now, which is the victim, is going to, how is she going to trust other people on her own care? And the second thing is that, how is the bill now comforting the patient in overall, in cases of policy perspective as well as patient perspective?
Thanks for the question. Taking the first question first, regarding the budgetary allocations, the current act doesn't talk about as to how the budget needs to be shared between the center and the state. It gives a framework within which financial divisions have to be promulgated by the respective center and the state authorities in the times to come, wherein as per requirements, the budgetary requirements will have to be sent to the appropriate authorities, and then they will be the ones who would be promulgating specific guidelines or policies for spending these budgetary allocations which are available to them. Also, to look into adequate spending of these financial implications, there is a provision for regular audit as well as reporting to the higher authorities, wherein the expenditure could be overseen to bring in forth that the budget has been spent adequately. As far as the second question is concerned regarding receiving remuneration for by the mentally ill person, as in this case it was a female, so the budget talks of remuneration with respect to the mental health treatment. It doesn't talk of sharing of rights in the property as far as the mental illness is concerned. However, the budget provides for the civil rights of the persons with mental illness, wherein a person with mental illness is to be treated at par as a normal citizen of India. There has to be no discrimination with respect to division of property or provision of civilian services to a person with mental illness. There is no separate allocation of remuneration for he or she being a mentally ill person. It is limited to the mental illness per se, and also the Act says that it is limited to the time of 10 years from the time of implementation of the Mental Health Care Act of 2017 till the time the Government of India is to make provisions for public health mental establishments wherein the treatment is to be provided free of cost as on case-on-case basis, right?
Adding on to that, the Act has a provision that the services which have been offered by the government, it needs to be divided on the basis of the population of that state. It has been clearly mentioned in the Act. But how much fund will be given, that we don't know. And regarding the property which you are talking about, the Act doesn't talk about the right to property to those mental patients with mental illness, though we can expect that in the forthcoming time, it may make some changes in it. Thank you.
In view of the time, we have a time for one more question. Kindly, there. Okay, sorry. Two more questions now after this.
Yeah. Good morning, everyone on the panel and everyone over here. I am a psychologist. I'm just curious to know whether this whole mental health care bill act has anything for those who are working with the mentally ill, the service care providers. So since we are not the patients, but we are directly dealing with these patients as maybe psychiatric social workers, psychiatrists, psychologists, nurses, other mental health professionals, does this act have anything for the mental health and well-being of the people dealing with them? Because I'm sure you all must agree with one point over here that even we do feel some sort of stress or some sort of problems while dealing with such a serious area. So I would just like to know your views on that. So anyone.
Thank you. Tamanad, would like to take it?
Regarding mental problems of persons who are dealing with these patient regarding if a person who deals with these patient populations, if he is developing he or she is developing any sort of a problem themselves, the act is largely silent, to the best of my knowledge. There is the provision in this act that these